Are you transitioning from tennis to pickleball, or just adding pickleball to your tennis game? In this video, I'm going to share with you 7 tips that will help you migrate your tennis skills onto the pickleball court and help you greatly improve your pickleball game. Let's get into it. Hello, my name is Tony Roy from Into Pickle and We Are Pickleball. Together with my partner CJ Johnson from Better Pickleball, we provide you the best online resource for learning how to play pickleball. Subscribe to our email list at WeArePickleball.com. I'll link to that below. And that way, make sure you're notified about everything that we put out, whether it's a video, a podcast, a blog post, whatever it is. You'll make sure you stay on top of all the current pickleball material. If you've been playing tennis for any amount of time, you have a good sense of eye-hand coordination, so ball coming, make swing, make contact with ball. You're going to have a sense of the length of the racket relative to the ball, and obviously there's going to be an adjustment between hitting with a racket that's this long and the paddle that's this long. You know, in a tennis racket, you're hitting the ball somewhere up in here. With a pickleball paddle, you're hitting the ball somewhere in here. So there's some difference with that. But one of the areas that you can mostly benefit from if you're transitioning from tennis is to look at using a more compact swing. So let me show you. I'm a left-handed player, and I played tennis for about 40 years. And let me show you, like a normal tennis swing, right, would be, say I was hitting the ball that way. I'd take the racket back like this, and then I would come through. So basically, I'd have a nice little backswing to be able to power that ball through. So in tennis, you know, the size of the racket, the weight of the ball, the length of the court require the imparting of a lot of energy. So this kind of a backswing and coming through, going through and through the ball is pretty normal. In pickleball, however, what you'll find is you'll find that instead of taking such a big swing in pickleball, taking the paddle back like this in pickleball, you'll benefit from having a much more compact swing, starting from around here on ground strokes, and then even farther up if you're dinking or hitting soft shots, especially up at the non-volley zone line. So one of the areas that you can really improve from tennis to pickleball is to look at the length of your swing. And instead of having a long swing, so you know a nice long swing like you would in tennis, is to try and compact that swing as much as possible in pickleball to where you're hitting a more compact stroke. You'll find that when you play pickleball, you greatly improve from this stroke mechanic. At the end of the video, I'm going to explain to you the difference between holding the paddle in a hinged position and an unhinged position, or a more natural wrist position. That's particularly helpful if you're a tennis player transitioning to pickleball, so make sure you stay tuned for that tip. Related to the amount of swing, related to how long your swing is, in tennis, what you'll see a lot is you'll see a sort of like a windshield wiper type of motion with the racket, where basically you come down onto the ball and then you roll over it. The reason you can do that in tennis is because you have strings on the racket and you have a ball that has some felt on it. It's also rubbery. So basically, as your racket makes contact with the ball, it basically almost like dives into or just basically buries itself in the felt on the ball. And that way you can kind of grab the ball with the strings and then flick it up, and then it'll cause the ball to spin. In pickleball, we're playing not with that type of ball, but we're playing with a hard ball. So we're playing with a hard surface ball with no felt on it. And we're also playing with a paddle that has no strings. So what you end up doing is you end up having basically a hard surface against a hard surface. Even if you have a paddle like this diadem icon that I'm using, which has some has grip on it, like almost like a rubbery surface, or if you're playing with a paddle that has a bunch of paint kind of grit on it, even with those, as I hit, I can't generate the same kind of lift on the ball as I can with a tennis racket and a felt ball. So if I use a windshield wiper type of motion in pickleball, it generally can lead to problems with your shots. So in pickleball, you want to think more about hitting through the ball. So you're going to make contact with the ball and hit through the ball. You can have some lift on it, it's fine. But what you're trying to avoid is you don't want the windshield wiper to be the primary driver. You want the paddle pushing through the ball to be the primary driver when you hit a pickleball, which may be different than the way you hit the ball when you play tennis. A concept that's related to the windshield wiper lift, so that big lift motion, is the grip that you use when you play. A lot of tennis players who come over to pickleball come over with a Western or semi-Western type of grip, so they're holding their pickleball paddle like this. What ends up happening is they're trying to hit in the same motion that they do in tennis, which is to bring the racket around like this, in this case the paddle, and then come up over it, which has that windshield wiper technique I was mentioning a minute ago. And what happens there is you have the same problem that you did that I just described, which is basically you have a hard surface against a hard surface, and this kind of upward motion is not going to work that well. The players that are successful with this grip basically come at the ball and they hit through the ball, they end up with some up on it, but basically they're still driving through that ball. But there's several limitations to this grip. You have a limitation on the forehand dink. So if I hit a low ball to your forehand side, you have to turn that paddle around. It's a very awkward kind of a grip, as you can tell, very awkward kind of a motion. The other problem that you run into is you run into a problem on the backhand side at the mid-level, because what happens is my paddle sits like this. So I have to find a way to force it over. So you'll see players like Riley Newman, players like that, who have this kind of a grip. They basically use their other hand to push that paddle over so that they're not sitting there with the paddle like this, resulting in the ball popping up and getting slammed. What I'd recommend is, if you can do this, if you can play pickleball with a more continental type of grip — some players call it an eastern grip, but basically it's a 90 degree grip where the paddle is 90 degrees from the court — that grip is going to give you the most variability and the most flexibility when you're playing pickleball, allowing you to play both backhand and forehand with the least number of limitations in your game, which are the kind of limitations you can have when you come at it with the western type of grip. By now you may have noticed that there's kind of a theme that runs through these, which is basically the idea of imparting spin on the ball. So, you know, like a windshield wiper, this kind of grip to impart spin, things like that. Pickleball players do use spins when they play pickleball. But a lot of times, until you get to be a pretty advanced player, you know, 4 or 5+, spins can actually be a detriment to your game because they introduce a possibility of error into your shots. And what happened, there's two types of spins. Obviously, there's a top spin, which is the one where the ball rolls over. If you play tennis, you know what that is. Or the underspin or the slice, which is where the ball spins the other way. And what ends up happening is tennis players will come in and they'll try and impart spin like this or impart spin like this with a lot of cut actions with their hands and their wrists, basically throwing the paddle around. And what ends up happening is their shots end up being erratic. So either they're missing into the net because the shot's not going where they wanted to go, or if you're doing a lot of this, that ball's floating up on you and you're getting smashed with balls. What we recommend is, particularly when you're first getting into the game, you're getting used to the game, play a more of a flat game, more of a neutral game. So basically you have the continental grip and you're coming at balls pretty neutrally. What you'll find is, even if you hit a neutral, say like what you would consider a flat forehand, what'll happen is, just because of the physics of how you hit it, the ball's gonna end up with some top on it anyway. You're gonna have some topspin as you hit it. So you're still gonna get the topspin that you want without having to do a lot of this kind of stuff with your wrist and with your elbow. And taking that part out of the game, taking a lot of those spins out of the game, will help your consistency. You improve your consistency, you'll have better results and enjoy the game better. Save the spins for later on in your journey when you're ready to add spins into your game, and then bring them in little by little. But initially, try and hit more of a flat game when you're transitioning from tennis to pickleball. The next tip is handling out balls. When you come from tennis, you're used to playing on a big court like this. This is a tennis court, regulation tennis court. In the middle, you can see a pickleball court drawn on it or painted on it with the light blue lines. So when you play tennis, I mean, you can see from the size of the courts the difference of the court size, right? When you come from tennis, you're used to having a much bigger court. That means that balls that are this high and maybe coming at a certain pace are going to land in because they have so much more space to work with. Once you step out onto the pickleball court, which is that size there, about a third or so of the size of a tennis court, and about half the size, if you will, on in terms of length, what you're going to find is that balls that you would hit on a tennis court that are going to go in on a pickleball court, a lot of times, are going to go out. So when you're on a pickleball court, if you get a drive that's coming around your shoulder, probably let those balls go and see if they go out. You got to change your mindset from the size of a tennis court to the size of a pickleball court. This next tip involves footwork. In tennis, a lot of times we're taught to move like this, or we're taught this kind of crossover step as we move around the court. And that makes sense on a tennis court. Tennis court's larger, we have to cover more space, so doing that crossover step is perfectly fine when you're playing tennis. The problem arises when you play pickleball is that we have this non-volley zone line here, or the kitchen line, this area up here. And so we play, a lot of this game is played up at this non-volley zone line here, and basically we're gonna try and get close to this non-volley zone line and really put pressure on our opponents and really limit angles. What happens is, if I'm up at the non-volley zone line and I cross like this, now this foot is inside the non-volley zone because the line's part of it. So what happens is, if I cross over like this into the non-volley zone line, or into the non-volley zone area, non-volley zone, now what happens is I have to get out of here in order to be able to volley the ball. So instead of moving like this in pickleball, the way we move in pickleball along the non-volley zone line or the kitchen line is we move with a shuffle. So we basically move with a shuffle back and forth. That prevents us or avoids us from stepping in inadvertently when we do a crossover like this and potentially violating the non-volley zone rule. One other tip I want to give you from this zone, the non-volley zone or the kitchen area, is tennis players a lot of time want to play like they do tennis, right? So they want to play doubles the way they play tennis. So what happens is the returner will be up the non-returner will be up here and the returner will be back there. And then the returner will return the serve and then stay back. And I'll show you some video in a second to show you how that looks in tennis. So you have the one player up, the one player back. Pretty common to play doubles that way, right? You just basically one stays back and hits baseline shots, one's up here volleying, and that's how you play. A lot of levels play that way. But in pickleball, you want to play up here, both up here, particularly on the returner serve. So if you're returning serve as a tennis player, don't return serve and stay at the baseline. Return serve, hustle up to the non-volley zone line, and play a better game. All right, so let me give you one more bonus tip, and this one has to do with how we interact between the paddle and our arm. So in tennis, when you play tennis, usually you're gonna hinge your wrist. What I mean by that is if I'm hitting a forehand, I don't hit forehands in tennis like this, right? Sort of bowling style, I hit them up here. The ball in tennis usually sits up, so I can usually come at it and hit it like this, or a backhand, I can hit it like this. So I'm hinging my wrist relative to how it would lay naturally. Look at, if I put my wrist down like this, this is kind of natural. As if I was just walking around, I'd hold it like this, right? And if I hold my racket like this, it lays down, which is not how I'm gonna hit my backhands. So what I end up doing in tennis is I end up hinging my wrist like this. So I end up hinging my wrist up before I hit. What happens with the hinge wrist, a couple of things. One is I'm putting tension on my arm. So you can do it yourself, grab your racket or your paddle and then hold it like this. This will be nice and relaxed. As soon as you hinge it up, you'll feel these muscles tense. And that's why this kind of a grip, this kind of a hinged grip and a pickleball paddle can cause difficulties when you're trying to reset or hit soft shots. It can be done. There's some of the top players in the world play like this and they're able to reset. So it's doable, but you're adding additional stress to your arm and more tension, as opposed to just letting the paddle relax like this. But the real reason to have this shot in pickleball is a pickleball ball or a pickleball doesn't bounce up as much as a tennis ball does. So what happens is, let's say I'm up at the non-volley zone line here, and I'm trying to hit a low, I'm trying to get to a low ball. So I'm trying to hit a low ball coming at me. So what happens is, I'll show you from the front. So what happens is, if I have my paddle like this, and I'm trying to hit a ball that's down at my feet, I have to get all the way down like this. And that's just very uncomfortable. This is not very, very comfortable. Now, if I leave my paddle down like this in a more natural position, I can just go down like this and get to the same spot. Still have to reach down, right, to get it, but I don't have to go down quite as far as I do if I hinge my wrist. So one piece of advice for tennis players is get used to playing with your hand in a sort of natural position without hinging the wrist, with the arm nice and relaxed. Get used to hitting some balls like that. That'll help you in particular when you're trying to hit really soft shots or when you're trying to go down to get a ball. That way you don't have to go all the way down like that by hinging your wrist. If you're transitioning from tennis to pickleball or just adding pickleball to your weekly repertoire, welcome to the game. I'll link to a couple more playlists up here so that you can add some more strategies and some ideas on how to serve and things like that into your game. If you want to know more about pickleball, join us at WeArePickleball.com and find out more about how to play your best pickleball. Hope to see you on the courts one day.